A very good evening to one and all. It gives us great pleasure to first invite the Honorable Chief Justice, Justice Sanjay Kishan Kaul, to preside over this function, as well as a lecture. And also Mr. Rakesh Kaul, who's here to give a lecture both on his book as well as share his views. Particularly, he wanted to share his views also with the students out here. The program as such, I will hand over completely to Mr. Rakesh. He wanted about 30 or 40 odd minutes to speak, after which our chief guest, Justice Kaul, will also address the gathering. Last 15 minutes will be left for the floor to ask any questions. Now over to Mr. Rakesh.
Thank you. So I want to start off by thanking the Chennai International Center for this opportunity. I also want to thank Honorable Chief Justice and Shivani. Delighted. This is a story of Shakti, and I'm delighted you're here to grace the occasion. But mostly, hats off to you, Chennai. My book tour started in New York, then I spoke at the Asia Society in Bombay. I spoke at the Bangalore International Center. But I have to say, you as the audience, your numbers coming for a literary book event gives it a very special glow, and I'm absolutely delighted to see so many youngsters here. And so by all means, ask questions at the end. The story began 12 years ago when I was researching my wife's last name. Her last name is Dhar. They are a very powerful, well-known clan of Kashmir. And I stumbled across this episode in the early 19th century when the very beautiful wife of a nobleman by the name of Birbal Dhar was abducted by the governor, Azim Khan, as part of some political vendetta. She knew that she would be dishonored, and so she committed suicide while his prisoner. History records that her last words were, "There will always be a Kotarani. Remember me to my husband." Now, I have been a student of Kashmir's civilization, and I thought I knew everything, but this was a new name to me. Certainly, there was a person by the name of Kotarani who was very much a symbol of resistance within the oral history of the Kashmiri Pandits. And I didn't know anything about her. So I researched it a little bit more, thinking I would tell my wife the story, and I couldn't find anything on her. Absolutely nothing. It was only later on I realized that she was the victim of one of the greatest cover-ups in Kashmir's history. But more on that later. Let me now start with, how do I move this forward? All right, page 2. Let me start with where I'm from. I'm from this little, you could call it hamlet, by the name of Ranavari. If some of you are from Kashmir Valley, you will recognize it. And it was a integrated community. On one bank of the river, the Hindus would live, on the other bank, the Muslims would live peacefully. It has a very hoary history, and much later on I discovered that it actually had a very deep connection with Kotarani. But if you were to talk to somebody from Ranavari today, he would tell you that he's engaged in a fight so that he can get to be able to exercise his rights for life, liberty, and happiness, and be able to live in the valley of Kashmir. If you were to go talk to the resident Kashmiris, they're engaged in their own fight because they think that they want freedom to be able to do what they want to do. So Kashmir has become a conflict zone. Everybody sort of has clarity on who their enemy is. And so for somebody introspecting on Kashmir, it raises two profoundly disturbing civilizational questions. The first one is, when did violence enter civil society in Kashmir? And the reason that's a very profound question is that this was such a remarkable society that Kalhanna, the great historian who wrote Raj Tarangani, remarked, he said, Kashmiris are a very strange people. You can have kings fighting with each other, ready to kill each other as to who will be the person who gets the throne, but the farmer will not even turn his head to look at them. And so there was a very clear sense of insulation between politics and civil society. And civil society kept the politics at arm's length. So something happened. When did it happen? How did violence enter the body politic of Kashmir? The second question is, in fact, even more important. And that's not a question for Kashmiris. That's a question for India. And perhaps for the world. We all know what people are fighting against. But is there anything in Kashmir that's worth fighting for? I mean, what is it? In a Darwinian world where things die every day, is there anything there that we are fighting for? And I don't think that in India there is clarity about that. So with these two questions in my mind, I began my journey in trying to understand who this Kotaran was. And voila. It turns out that this book, Youngsters, when you read it, you'll find it's a love story. It's a star-crossed love story because she was a young girl, just like many of you young women there. And she's supposed to have been very, very beautiful. So in the course of her life, seven men pursue her, some good, some not so good, some ugly, and one at the end who was pure evil. She's described in the novel as always captivating, but never captive. And I think that can begin to give you a hint of what kind of a woman she was. As you start reading the story, you will suddenly begin to feel the way Rama took his wife Sita on the Pushpak Vimana. You'll begin to see in your cultural memes that there are things in that story that you recognize and that you begin to resonate. And then suddenly, as you get into the groove of the story, you will have this moment of complete resonance. And that moment, which in Kashmir we call by the Sanskrit term pratyabhijna, that sense of identification, is my reward as an author for my Valmiki Shoka moment. Because the story started in sorrow. Though today we are here to celebrate the rebirth of an extraordinary queen. Chapter one of the story is set in one of the greatest universities of the world, a university by the name of Sharda Peet. It is right across the border, line of control from Baramulla, in what we would call the Kishanganga river valley, and traditionally now they call it the Neelam Valley. For 600 years, it was the place to go to. In fact, until very recent times, when you would graduate from Banaras University, before you could graduate, you would take three steps in the direction of Sharda Peeth University. That was an indicator that that was the level you were aspiring to. So it's there that she's trained on the grand equation of Sharda Peeth. And this grand equation of life was very simple. It was, look, youngsters, if I was to ask you, what do you want? You'd probably say, I want a job, or I want to become a doctor, or I want to become an engineer, or I want to run an NGO, or I want to run into politics, right? At Sharda Peeth University, the answer would have been, I want it all. I want it all. And the mission of the university was to help you get it all. So, we all know that there are limitations. But at Sharda Peeth, these limitations were basically considered to be limitations that arise out of your self-ignorance, not out of anything else. But they didn't just say, okay, you're ignorant and so you're limited. Over the centuries, they had developed technologies, and depending on your proclivity, there were three ways you could remove these limitations. You could go through the mind-based approach, using logic, and go searching for truth. Our Honorable Justice deals with that day in, day out. What is the truth of the reality here? If you were more driven by your sensory perception, more left brain, then you had the beauty-seeking techniques. And if you resonated more with energy, shakti, you had the consciousness-seeking techniques. Now, I have put in three simple sentences a journey which, in terms of truth-seeking, was about 5,000 years long. Beauty-seeking was at least 1,000 years long. And energy, well, if you believe Sadhguru, he thinks that's a journey that has taken 12,000 years. A word about the beauty-seeking. Some of you may have heard of Professor Sheldon Pollock. He's a gentleman at Columbia University, scholar of Sanskrit. He's the person that the Murti translations are being led by. He believes that that contribution of aesthetics and beauty seeking is probably India's greatest contribution to humanity. So three simple things. What is truth? What is beauty? And what is consciousness? That was the formula. That was the software of Kashmir. Every Kashmiri, whether a visitor or a tourist or a graduate, that was the software they were trained. Now, this particular software helped you achieve the full life. Some people got there further, some people got there less far. But the immediate benefit of this pathway was creativity. Creativity, what we call innovation today. That was the force multiplier you would get as an individual. Yesterday, I was asked in Bangalore, why is it that Kashmir contributed 90% to Indic poetics? Why did Kashmir do this? Why did it? No, it's not Kashmir, it's the technology. They developed these techniques, and what it did was, it enhanced your creativity. You basically got put on steroids, not physical steroids, but steroids of the mind. So after she graduates, which is a remarkable Q&A session that you will enjoy, those of you who are students, her father takes her to a daranga, which was the name for a fortress, and trains her in the military warfare. At that point, Zojila Pass is a very scary place. For those of you who haven't gone there, it's worth going. It's really quite a journey to go to Kargil from Kashmir. I am having some difficulty with this in terms of the cursor. Okay, I lost it completely now. Okay, can you get me back? So he takes her back, she graduates, and it is at that point when she is brought to court that Kashmir undergoes a savage attack by a Turkoman by the name of Dulacha. He comes in, everybody flees, the noble people, the military goes into the defensive stance in the fortresses, he kills everybody. Jona Raja, the historian, writes that Dulacha's army were like locusts. They didn't even leave a blade of grass. Dulacha takes 50,000 young Kashmiris as slaves, but then he realizes he had overstayed in the valley and winter was coming. He had been short-sighted, he had destroyed everything, so there was no food even for his army, and he needed to get out of the valley. So he asked the local Kashmiris how to get out. They tell him. Dulacha gets trapped in a snowstorm. All 125,000 people die. One of the horrific tragedies of Kashmir. In this horror, a refugee who had come into Kashmir by the name of Rinchina takes advantage of the situation and he kills the king of Kashmir. He kills Kota Rani's father, who was the chief of the military. He imprisons Kota Rani and gives her a choice. Either die or marry me. So Kota Rani marries her and marries him. But subsequent to the marriage, Rinchina, the gentleman who was the refugee, converts to Islam at the behest of a gentleman by the name of Shamir, who himself was a refugee and had come into Kashmir to gain sanctuary. Rinchina gets assassinated by his own best friend, and it is at that time that Kota Rani becomes a ruler in her own right and a queen.
Just keep clicking this, you'll keep moving.
Right here? Okay. Okay. When she becomes the queen, she rules it in a way that is very selfless. She is very supportive of the arts. She rebuilds her society. Another Turkoman, even more dangerous than Dulacha, attacks Kashmir. But Kota Rani, if you like Chhatrapati Shivaji, you will love her. What military stratagem she comes up with, and she not only defeats Achala's army, Barachala actually dies. Some of you may remember of the floods that occurred in Kashmir recently, a year or two ago. Would you believe it? Kota Rani is the only person in Kashmir's history who said, look, this valley keeps getting floods periodically. I'm going to do something about it. She built the canal that was a bypass canal. It's to this day called Kotkul. There is a, in fact, a very popular bridge over it called Kanyakadal Bridge. I can tell you, no Kashmiri knows who Kotkal was named after because of this cover-up about the queen. And when she ultimately reaches the end of her life, Jomo Raja, the historian, gives a most remarkable eulogy on her. He says that this queen completely rebuilt the wealth of her people. Imagine, in 15 years' time, to take a kingdom that was completely ravaged, rebuild its wealth. And then he says something even more enigmatic. And the only way I've been able to analyze it, I think, correctly, is to recognize that Buddhist influence in Kashmir was very strong. And he says that he uses the term blue lotus, that she was to her people what the moon is like to the blue lotus. And blue lotus is a symbol of peace. And to the enemy, she was like the white lotus. And white lotus is a symbol of pacification. So she was able to bring peace and security and prosperity to her people. And to the outside world, the enemies, she was able to pacify them. Truly, by all counts, an amazing woman. So this whole project took about 12 years. It took 7 years to collect materials from Germany, Persia, from the leading scholars that had this information, bits and pieces. And a couple of things come out of it. In terms of what seemed to be not only Kota's way of operating, but also very much the way Mahatma Gandhi went and deep into his civilizational ethos to give strength to the people. She went deep into the civilizational ethos of Kashmir to give strength to her people. And the first one was really the notion of swatantra, that you have to be free as a human being. And if you're free as a human being, you'll not only be happy, but you'll make people around you happy. But with that freedom comes a responsibility. And in Kashmir, that word, the term for that was lihaz. And lihaz was the responsibility that, look, I want you to respect me, but I respect you too. I'm tolerant of your way of life. And the net result of that was diversity. And there is nothing that causes society to progress faster than to respect diversity. Because diversity is what causes the tugs of competition, cooperation, contests, but also, you know, there is a best of breed that comes out of that process. And so it's not surprising that it was a Kashmiri Pandit, Vishnu Sharma, who most aggressively promoted this notion of Vasudeva Kutumbakam in the well-known stories, Panchtantra. And so it's not surprising that in Kota's Kashmir, that people get astonished that there is a Jewish character. But at that time in Kashmir, there were not just Jews, there were Parsis, there were Jains, we have evidence of Sogdians, certainly Chinese, people from all over. And the reason it worked was because the highest truth of Kashmir was this notion of oneness. That Kashmir believed that anybody who thinks in terms of duality is delusional. And so this notion of oneness, that you as a human being, nature around you, the universe, we're all connected. We're all one. So it was that notion that enabled this queen to bring her people together, to mobilize their inner strength, and rebuild that society. So, here's the delightful part. There isn't a person who has read this book who hasn't experienced something wonderful. And you can go on the Facebook page or you can read the comments on Amazon.com. Each person has tried to describe their own experience. And I'll come to the reason why that is so. But our ancient writers had a very interesting phrase for it. They would say, the word is the seed, the reed is the flower, and then, of course, the rasa, the taste of the fruit is what you should experience out of great writing. I don't know if this is a great piece of literature, this book, but I can tell you, this is the most radical book to come out of India. Now, that should catch the attention of those people who normally associate the word radical with, you know, more leftist ideologies or more fundamentalist ideologies. But I use the word radical in the same way as my other better known alma mater, Saul Bellow, uses it, which is radical is that which is deeply researched and then uncovers fundamental truths that are a revelation. And so, in that sense, this book does proudly make a claim that it is radical, and now I'll take you through the inner engineering of that aspect of the story. Now, the queen is center stage, it's a great story, but now I want to, because we've got some very bright young people here, I want you to understand this. This is, folks, the first book written in the English language that is solely written using Indic literary principles. You can call them Kavya principles, Katha writing principles. This is the first book in English. So, you know, you can drive a car. All cars will get you where you want to go. But when you drive a German car, you can feel a different experience. And when you read this book, you'll feel there's something different about it. It is also the first book in the English language that has been written in the Shanta Rasa with the Virasa Bhava. The Shanta Rasa is considered to be the most difficult rasa to do a literary composition. There are only two books that have been written in the Shanta Rasa. The first one, obviously, is Mahabharata, and the second one is Kalhanna's Raj Tarangani. It is an extremely complex thing, which is why nobody else has attempted it. There is a play that was done in the 16th century in Shanta Rasa, but that's about it. Certainly, this one is in English, which makes it a little bit more complicated. What is especially joyful is that Shanta Rasa was formulated by Abhinav Gupta, the grand polymath of Kashmir. This is the year that we are celebrating Abhinav Gupta Acharya's 1000th anniversary, so I feel very, very proud about it. In the interest of time, I'm going to just touch one or two more. It's the first book that actually lays out the doctrine of war that should be followed in Kashmir. I think people get shocked when I tell them that the biggest war manual in the world was written in Kashmir. It is 8,000 shlokas longer than Ramayana. It will take 13 years for the University of Hali to translate it. It'll come out in 2017. They have been giving me periodic installment peaks at what's coming out of it. But the fundamental notion, how does a Kshatriya kill? And I'm obviously using the language of 14th century. How does a Kshatriya kill so that he kills right, so that he kills without suffering karma, so that he kills with total merciless detachment? That question, folks, has only been asked and answered in Kashmir. And this book brings that to the surface. One more point I'll talk about, and you can ask me a question on it because it'll make for a good discussion, is it's the first book that actually lays out what the Indian model of femininity was in a land which prided itself on women first. And ask me a question on that, and I'll give you more details, but I can assure you it is not the model of femininity that people in India are fighting for today. It's much more. It's not the traditional model that men and women are complementary, two halves of a whole. It's not the Western model, women are equal to men. No, no, no. It's something far more exciting, something far more powerful. So we can talk about it there. So let me quickly gravitate to the present, which is people ask me, okay, now, what's the relevance? Because Kashmir is burning, right? Everybody wants to talk about relevance. So look, you always want to understand history so that you can have a better future. That's the whole point of history. History exists so that you can create a better future. And you know what? If you are in the mode of reading the newspaper and every day there is something going on in Kashmir that some deranged mind or some psychopathic ideology is up to, you know. So what this book does is it actually first time analyzes over the course of a very long period, 5,000 years, what's going on here. It identifies what it calls a Chaturanga formation that came into Kashmir and essentially was uncontested and is uncontested to this day because people have not diagnosed what is this military formation that we are fighting there. And so the story in a nice way does that. But if you objectively look at any of the metrics of Kashmir, essentially that civilization is going straight down. And so there's been a lot of focus in India on what I call the hardware elements, you know, land, okay, international line of control, Pakistan also, Kashmir also, land, land, land. There's a lot of focus on the hardware side. Folks, the problem is in the software. They've messed up the software of the Kashmiris. And they messed up the software of the Kashmiris over centuries. You're not going to be able to solve it in one day. You're especially not going to be able to solve it if you don't go in and say, I'm going to put an antivirus program and clean out the software. So nobody has done that. Nobody's even thinking along these lines. Move on quickly. This is a great moment. It's a great moment because the rebirth of an extraordinary woman. As a queen, she will certainly rank as one of the greatest rulers of Kashmir. If you were to go to ask any Kashmiri, who do you think is it? Well, a king, that's a good one. They may mention the name of Zainul Abidin, popularly known as Bud Shah, Bud meaning Bada, Shah meaning emperor, you know, a great emperor. And now what I'm positing is, but you know what? There's actually a Badshahi, that a woman who's greater than this guy. She was a better military warrior than him. She rebuilt the economy better than him. And the infrastructure projects that Zainul Abidin did with bridges and all that is nice, but she fixed the problem of the river. So somebody who's a contender. She also represents at a time when there's enormous reprogramming of Kashmir's history being done, and the locals are being told, oh, no, you're really a tribe that came from the Middle East, and now you came into Kashmir. There's a lot of nonsense going on there. She represents the last link of a civilization that was integrally linked to India. She was also a unifier. And people get astonished when I tell them, and this is the first and only time I'm going to bring religion into it, because it's really not about religion. Her story is not about religion. I tell them that Islam was in Kashmir for 500 years before Kota. And she is the last ruler that Kashmir had, where essentially there was no tension. So she was a unifier, and she was the last one. And after that, it was the beginning of the end. But the last thing is this. I call her Kota the trustee, and there's a question now for all those who are not Kashmiris, but Indians. You know, you'll see people make a statement, Kashmir is the crown of India. You may hear people say, the highest of Indic thinking peaked in Kashmir. So, you know, you'll see stuff like that being said. You'll see people saying, you know what, Shankaracharya went to Sharda Peeth, ascended the throne of wisdom, gained Shakti, brought her back, opened Sringari Math, all that stuff. Okay. Look, the reality is this. For 600 years, that was the center where enormous technologies were developed to maximize human potential. All these technologies are written in a lipi called Sharda. Today, I don't think there's even one person who knows that. So, if we want to be a great civilization again, if we want to maximize our potential and impact in the world, we have a 5,000-year legacy that we can take advantage of. We can choose not to do that as a people. But here is the wake-up call. There are 20 universities around the world that are working furiously to unlock those secrets, to begin to incorporate them in their own societies, and to begin to take advantage of what those technologies are. Now, it's up to us. Do we want to benefit from what our ancestors gave us, or do we choose to close our eye? Kota is the living symbol of all of these things. She is one story, but she's also many stories. I thank you all for coming tonight and hearing the story of Kota Rani.
Thank you, Mr. Rakesh. May I now invite the Honorable Chief Justice to. Before the Honorable Chief Justice delivers his speech, I must introduce him to you, though he doesn't need an introduction at the moment after 2 years in Chennai. You can sit on for 2 minutes at this point. Well, it was not as a Chief Justice we had invited him here. Firstly, as another Mr. Kaul. And not just as a Mr. Kaul. Well, in judiciary, if I may say, after what Mr. Rakesh said, we could even call him another Kota Raja. And the second point is, when we went through his profile officially on the website, it was a very short one. Luckily, when I was a law officer and my predecessor also as an advocate general, we had a research also done about him, And even his history goes back to about 500 years. And his earliest of ancestors, Swami Jageshwar Nath Kaul, he was a custodian of the Ganapatiya temple in Srinagar sometime in 15th century. And later in 17th century, Mughal Emperor Jahangir appointed one of his descendants, Pandit Shankar Kaul, as one of his royal officials. In the 19th century, another of his ancestors, Pandit Lal Kaul, was a minister at the court of Kabul, who later formed an alliance with Maharaja Ranjit Singh, who was crucial in capturing Kashmir, along with the Sikh army. And thereafter, later, his own great-grandfather, Raja Suraj Kishan Kaul, was a revenue minister in the Regency Council and adorned the legislative council for the Punjab province. And his son, Sir Daya Kishan Kaul, was hailed as a great diplomat and statesman and functioned as a finance minister in the states of Jammu and Kashmir, Alwar and Patiala. His lordship's grandfather, Raja Upinder Kishan Kaul, also enjoyed a distinguished career in public service. Now I think you will realize that Justice Kaul is not here just being as a Chief Justice here, but in his own right as another Mr. Kaul, having his own claim to history in Kashmir. Now I request the Honorable Chief Justice to share a few words.
Rakeshji and enlightened audience. Well, when Arvind asked me first to chair the session, I willingly accepted for more than one reason, that it gives me an opportunity to be here to be amongst you. And my introduction to Rakeshji was incidental. A couple of years back when I was in the US, I was introduced to him, and then some way he contacted his mother in Delhi, and then began our association, as both the families realized their own association and how people had, you know, gone their own ways over a period of time. It has always been a pleasure to listen to him, because he is an encyclopedia on Kashmiri history, traditions, conventions. So I have had the benefit of a lunch which lasted 4 hours while I listened to what he was saying on different aspects of Kashmir, and another Dr. Muttu who was there, two of them debating issues and I trying to understand the complexities of the history. Let me say what comes to my mind. I've had read part of the book, not fully, I must confess, as yet, is what I've always believed, and I always say that in our community there is no question of empowerment of women. It has already taken place hundreds of years ago. For two reasons. Education was always very important for women, and the purse string remained with the women. An empowerment of women is always, in today's context also, being thought about in terms of economic empowerment and educational empowerment. This was part of the society of ours. It has remained so. And when you refer to the book, the importance of the Sharda Peeth, the inculcation of education for women, which was prevalent at that stage of time itself. Yes, the book also conveys that the women had to go through a tougher time to clear the same exam possibly than the men would have to do. But that's how it was. And her evolution thereafter as a queen, as a warrior, as a diplomat, as a strategist, in all matters. In fact, I don't know whether anybody is from the Punjab side here, but in the north there is this ceremony of Karwa Chauth. Okay, you must be knowing. Karwa Chauth is when the wife keeps a fast for the whole day, and the night sees the husband besides the moon and starts to eat. We have no such customs in our community, so. I was once talking to Rakeshji and said, look, whenever somebody asked me, I said, no, our wives don't keep it. We have a reverse, we have a Karvi Chauth. There's no Karwa Chauth here. So he said, but you are right, you know. So I said, how am I right? He said, no, there was a day in a year when the husband would treat the wife specially. And there would be rose petals in water, and the wife would be bathed in it and looked after and treated specially for that day, completely reversed. And when we heard about it, of course, the question which arose from his wife and my wife was, where did this tradition go away, you know? So, that's one aspect of the matter, I think, which is very important of the book. In the current context of what is going on in Kashmir, ours is a very small community, I must say. We are maybe about 700,000 people all over the world, 7 lakhs of us, out of which 50% were in the valley. 50% spread out in different parts because it's not a business community, it's a community who goes by its education and education alone. They're not traders, they're not business people, not good at it, I think, by and large. From this 3,500 people, we have about 2,500 left now. That's all that's left in the valley. So he talks about the challenges which is there, why people want to go back and establish their roots, why some of us, despite all adversaries, still want to keep our roots, because we feel if we lose it completely, we lose some part of our roots. So periodically when you say people have our, this is the 6th or the 7th migration which has taken place, people have moved out, but people periodically came back and some people came back to get back to their roots. Where does this violence stem from? The period I've spent, I never lived in Kashmir, but since my grandparents were there, at least 2 to 3 months in a year used to be spent there at the summer vacations time. It was one of the most peaceful places you can think about. You could walk in any time of the day and night without any problem. People used to believe, actually, till 80s I would say that nobody locked houses. There's no concept of locking houses. And whatever happened, the arguments were verbal in character rather than physical in character. Rakeshji of course knows that, you know, among the boat people called the Hanjis, there is a habit that they fight it, you know, fight in the sense of keep arguing a lot and, you know, battle it out. So the two ladies and the boat women would fight, and the evening would dawn, the basket would be kept reverse, and everybody go home. The idea is we'll begin tomorrow, you know, our battle. If you fired once in the year, the whole crowd would disperse. That used to be the tradition. But somewhere from the mixture of a community of the Sufi tradition, the Kashmiri Pandit tradition, the fact that there were mostly not converts only who were there, something went wrong over a period of time from the 80s, where I think we were not able to perceive what was going wrong. And we are faced with the situation today, and at a stage when we thought that things were better, I was regularly now going back at least once a year there, went back last in May. We have the last 3 months of a terrible time, I think, where most of us have not been able to go. And again, it looked like the whole thing has gone back by at least a decade. So, as he said, somewhere we need the software to understand what is going wrong there. Why this is happening, why the traditions have gone. And the challenge is that a huge new generation has come up post 1989-1990, which has not seen the times which the previous generations have. They do not understand what equations were. As when I went, somebody said they've never seen the two communities live in harmony as it is, because they've been in like a war zone for a long period of time. And some part of the repercussions of what we face today, I think, arise from that. I can only say that for most of the people of our community, it's a very sentimental issue to be able to have a reach to our homeland. And I think the civilization which is here, which you have seen, people will understand that why everybody wants to connect to their past, which is necessary. And it's, I think, a challenge for our country today to see how everybody can be brought in the mainstream, how people who lived in difficult situations can be brought back to their home and hearth. I believe it's difficult to do so in ghettos, but what is required is rehabilitation in wherever they were. Very difficult task, because people have gone ahead and, you know, gone forward, and the next generation amongst everybody has also gone forward. But some beginning would have to be made if the mix of the population, the mix of the cultures which is prevalent there has to be brought back. I have been telling Rakesh to you all through that the last couple of years that you must write, not only write about the last queen, but I believe he potentially, you know, has immense knowledge of so many aspects of history, so many aspects of culture, so many aspects of significance of rituals. That is to tell him that you owe it a duty to, you know, put pen to paper, as they say in the traditional sense. Now you, of course, put your finger to the computer, but so that there is preservation of it. In fact, this issue of the Sharda script, I was telling him that some of the older scriptures are in Sharda script, as he says. Even the Sun Temple of Marthand, which is there, there used to be records like there in Haridwar, where your family, you could go and trace your family history. Now, records from there have been taken by the, every Pandit had his own set of records, and they've all gone away taking their own records with them. And I have not been able to, for example, try to, in the last 2 years, trying to locate who is the person who is taking my family record. And the original recordings were in a script which is not understood today, nobody understands. Very few people, but he was mentioning that there are some people now who are making an effort to see that the script is revitalized and there are people available who can read through it. And the little irony is that the significance of this is felt more in the foreign countries than what we feel. They possibly realize it better than what we feel. And the encouraging part to me to have come here has been to not only understand a different aspect of our country, I think, in my last 2 years of stay here, but I find the significance in trying to preserve its history, I find is far more here than I would say in some parts of the north. I think we should take a cue from that, and to the extent all of us can collectively do so, to see that that history is not lost to us. I would not like to come between the audience and Rakesh ji, and it's been a great privilege to be here. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now we will have, for the next 10 or 15 minutes, questions both with Mr. Rakesh and those who would like to also ask anything to the Honorable Chief Justice. He is also available. We'll just circulate the mics.
Sir, these aspects which you said are being translated, there are many universities working on them. What do they relate to? I mean, what is that secret that you're talking about? Does it relate to the arts? Does it relate to warfare? Does it relate to literature?
So, I think that in the West, people now having achieved a sufficient degree of material affluence are becoming more inner directed. As they become more inner directed, they want to better understand who they are and how do they maximize their potential. There was only one place in the world that front center developed answers to that. So, for example, we are all very proud that United Nations has declared yoga as, you know, something that they'll celebrate once a year. Now, all of India has contributed to yoga, but Kashmir has disproportionately contributed to yoga. Patanjali was a Kashmiri. Vagyan Bhairav Tantra is a Kashmiri text. And Yogvashishta is a Kashmiri text. And I mean, I'm mentioning the more seminal documents. But I'll tell you a very interesting short story. There was a minister of war in the 11th century by the name of Rasavanta. And he starts off. It's a very short thing. He says, you know, I'm Minister of War of Kashmir. I have no time for Patanjali's Yoga Sutra. Who's going to sit and meditate? After all, you can meditate and you may get nothing. So I got to find a better way. I got to find a faster way. And so he wrote this delightful, short, 2-page document where he starts off in the first stanza and says, this is the fastest way to get the power of awakening. And it's 22 verses of awakening. And you know what? I actually tested some of that stuff, and it works. Now, why is it that in India, we are focusing on Hatha Yoga and Patanjali Yoga, when in India, the knowledge had moved way beyond that? And why is it in the West, we have somebody translating Hasavantas, fast track technology? That's what happens when you lose touch with your own body of knowledge and somebody else leapfrogs you. So today, all of us are very busy. Right? We all are looking for the fastest way. Hasavanta is the answer. But nobody in India is talking about Hasavanta. So that's just a very small example. But creativity is key. That's the key benefit that you get very, very quickly. You have read the book.
I've read the book.
Oh, can you take 2 or 3 sentences and share what, or how did you react to it?
I'll ask you the question on that.
All right.
And I think it's a very riveting book. But what I want to ask you is, why do you, first of all, you made Ravana, the brother, look so pathetic. And you killed him also very badly.
That is one.
The second thing. When you throughout the book, you see that when there is some trouble, he goes back to Sharda Peeth. And that linkage of governance and, normally something it amazed me in the sense that it's probably what US is doing in terms of many of the presidents taking people from the universities to address their knowledge. But it wasn't something like that. It was something as if the Sharda Peeth itself was determining the strategy with Potarani, especially when it came to those little bit of wars in which he had to do that. And finally, you made it look villainous. At the same time, there was that streak of extremism shown there in between, even among the Muslim community, the Islamist community which came in, except for that Bulbul Shah, the others who came in, and one of them who killed somebody in the court, if you recall, that was a very, very poignant point in the course of the story. And he was allowed to escape. And when he came in, knowing that he's a weed, you still allowed him to not only survive, thrive, but also finally kill the queen, in some sense. And you made that lover of Potarani die such a miserable death. He was such a hero. I mean, I'm just asking this.
First, thank you very much for having read the book. And thank you for saying it's riveting. Honorable Judge, what's the correct legal term? I plead mea culpa here, or you plead guilty? So look, the book is very deeply researched. So it turns out in one of those, this book opens so many questions that
are worth inquiring. I didn't make her brother be Ravan. It just turns out that her father was Ramchandra and he named his son Ravan. And as you know in the book, historically, he turns out to be the first nobleman of Kashmir who actually becomes a traitor and crosses over to the other side. That's all history. I have virtually nothing I can do except report it the way it is. Now the connection between Shardapith and royalty. Again, that is historically a fact. The role of the, and this was true of many Hindu kingdoms, so this is not necessarily limited to Kashmir. The city was built on a sacred mandala that was architected by the priests. The sacred mandala in Kashmir had 8 bhairavs that protected the city. And Shardapith's role in terms of advising the king was to sort of manage the unseen forces for the protection of the kingdom. So it was natural that the king would go to Shardapith or the queen would go to Shardapith. That is not atypical behavior in the 14th century. Now let's come to Bulbul Shah. Again, I just faithfully replayed history. Bulbul Shah came. By all counts, he was a very peaceful person. By all counts, he was very venerated by everybody. And so I simply have presented him the way most authorities and scholars do. And then you've touched briefly about the character who's not so nice. And again, him and virtually every other secondary character. See, historians write dry stuff. Now, some of your historians, don't get angry with me. You have a job to do, and you do it professionally. But historians have a bias that they write about kings and queens and important people. They don't write about the smaller guys, right? But I spent years researching, and if I could find the character of a barber in a play written the 14th century, I extracted that, and like a plastic surgeon, I grafted that into the book. So the book has a very authentic feel. As far as the fakir is concerned, his physical description, which is very striking, if you remember how the Kashmiris react when they first see him, that is taken lock, stock, and barrel from an actual description of a fakir. And then some of his actions are totally taken from a very authoritative book published by Professor K.N. Pandita. On the title of the book is A Muslim Missionary in Kashmir. That'll make your hair stand at the end when you read it. What I have taken out is actually a very diluted version. So everything that I have done is really reflecting accurately what the characters were about, and therefore I'm not at fault here. I'm just trying to put a story but also maintain the integrity.
The Western idea of equality or the idea of gender roles. I am very intrigued to know, sir, what are you exactly referring to when you talk about feminism in the context of the book?
All right, so if I make you happy, will you buy the copy of the book? All right. So, you know, old ancient civilizations like the Kashmiri Pandits are very interesting, as Honorable Judge said, because they have a database, and especially if they happen to be civilizations that kept a record, like the Kashmiri Pandits did, you can actually go and analyze a lot of things. So the first thing that was interesting about Kashmiri Pandits is that the highest truths of that society were controlled by the women. So when you look at the highest truths of the land, Durvasa, and this is true also for broader Indic thinking, Durvasa was charged to come and, you know, teach those truths. Durvasa taught them to Trimbaka. Trimbaka had a daughter whose name, we only know her as Ardh Trimbaka. She is Ardh meaning half of Trimbaka. So she was a daughter. All of Kashmiri higher truths emanate from her. Fast forward to Abhinav Gupt, who some of you know, who I talked about earlier. Abhinav Gupt's father's teacher was Kayurvati. Fast forward to Kota Rani's time. When she dies, you have another woman, a young woman by the name of Lalla, the mystic poet. Lalla was around 19 years old. So I can go on. So the first thing about Kashmir you have to understand is, unlike any other civilization, the highest truths were not controlled by a patriarchal system. They were controlled by a matriarchal system. That's the first thing. The second thing you have to understand is that in terms of femininity in Kashmir, the word I would use is fearless dynamic symmetry. So it was not complementary, it was symmetry. Man and women, symmetrical, but dynamic symmetry and fearless. What that implies is, in the absence of the man, what happens to the Eastern model of men and women are two halves of a whole? If the man is not there, what happens? Woman is only half, right? What happens to the Western notion of equality if the man is not there? But in the Shakta framework, which is what femininity is referred to in Kashmir, in the Shakta framework, the woman is complete even in the absence of a man. She is total, whole, has all the power, all the Shakta. Now you may say, Rakesh, that's bullshit. That's all nonsense, metaphysical. But somehow when the architecture of the highest principles is designed that way, you find something wonderful happening in the society. You find that Kota Rani was the last queen of Kashmir, but she was not the only queen. Kashmir had a series of very powerful queens. So clearly that society had values that permitted them to promote women to the highest spot in the land. Now, we've already talked about the fact that in Kashmir, Karwa Chauth was the exact reverse to what you see in the plains. We've talked about Valentine's Day in Kashmir, which is Madna Trayodoshi. Such a beautiful custom. I mean, you youngsters, you want to do Valentine's Day? Go open Nilmat Purana. Read about Valentine's Day in Kashmir, which happens around February, March. It is so beautiful. The husband, the night before, would take a big pitcher of water. He would fill it with flowers. In the morning, this gets risque, don't worry, you're all adults. In the morning, he would scrub his wife with the scented flowers. He would present her with new clothes to wear. They would go out for a picnic. Then they would come back. He and she would pray to Kamadev together, the god of love. And I'm going to stop there. Go read Nirmal Purana. So, last one. This will shock you. Because I want to show the power that Kashmiri women had. Even Kashmiris don't know when they're getting married and the priest is mumble, mumble, you know? And they say, yeah. They don't know. A Kashmiri woman asked, see, in Kashmir, it was not a matriarch. The woman was Shakti, but it was not a matriarchal system the way it's in the South. But nonetheless, she had the power. Now, where does a woman exercise her power most? It's at the time of marriage, right? She has to decide who she wants to get married. But in Kashmir, God expressed itself in a very remarkable way. In Kashmir, traditionally, the children were sort of called Parvati Putra. Not, they were more associated with the mother. So the woman would get to ask the man face to face before marriage, "Sir, are you potent so that when we marry, I can be a mother and have children?" And the man had to give her a commitment and say, "Yes, I've been eating Aushadhalyas and all kinds of herbs and all that stuff, and I will deliver a performance." It is a remarkable model of femininity, and it translated itself in daily life where women were free, where women were joyous, and when that women are joyous, you know, the whole world prospers. Long answer, but I hope it's
satisfying. Sir, you mentioned that the current problem of Kashmir,
yes,
as you rightly pointed out, is really not hardware related, like line of control and so on, but more on the softer side. What, according to you, are the 2-3 headline prescriptive items which we need to tackle on the softer side to solve this problem oneself?
Look, in the case of Kashmir specifically, what was done was you have to first understand how they were made to lose that sense of peace, that sense of identity, that sense of calm, right? You have to first diagnose it. And the first thing they were told was, in a land of oneness, create a sense of the other. Again, this is not about religion. This is about a sense of otherness. Now, how did they create the sense of otherness? They were told that if historically the button on your shirt is on the right side, you now, sir, will put the button on the left side. They were told, oh, everybody climbs a horse from the left side, you, sir, will climb a horse from the right side. This is not Rakesh Kaul saying this. This is an Englishman who came to Kashmir and wrote about this bizarre indoctrination. So the first thing you have to understand is this sense of otherness was created deliberately in a society of oneness. The second thing that was done was they were told, destroy your history. Now, we've seen that phenomenon elsewhere too. Destroy your history. So they have no sense of their history. They think that there was darkness. When the truth is, they were part of one of the great civilizations of Earth, and look at the darkness that has now fallen. So we in India, and especially as Hindus, we believe everything is about removing ignorance. There isn't anybody out there educating Kashmirs on who they were, what were they about, how were they manipulated? How did the closing of the great Kashmiri mind happen? It is one of the tragedies that a mind that could encompass the universe today just has gone dark. The Chaturanga forces are identified in the forces story. They can be counteracted. The software can be cleaned up. But that requires a certain amount of us getting our act together. But it's a doable thing.
Nothing between the two communities are common.
Everything is common.
Even surnames, you find among the two communities, they are common surnames, both of the community and the prince. Yeah. But in itself is, you can get Muslim also. Surname on the name.
Thank you.
one query to you. In a sense, I disagree with what you say about the ignorance bit. I feel, and I can somewhat vouchsafe that even today, Kashmiris, whether Hindu or Muslim, are among the most intelligent people not only in India but in the world. And I know that for a fact. And it's not said by me. We embarked on a training of Kashmiri students, leading corporates in the country. One of the first experiments was done by CII, it was done in Mumbai, in the Godrej Institute of Learning. And this is stated by those people who taught them, mm-hmm. that they found that every Kashmiri boy and girl who came for the training mm-hmm. was either equal or more intelligent than any other student of any other part of the country. My counter voice in this question, because you are one of the leading experts on the civilization, is, do you think that, and I think it is, mm-hmm. that whatever is happening in Kashmir today is the result of geopolitical influences have always governed Kashmir's history, politically at least. The point that you mentioned about the farmer not looking right or left is perhaps an indicative factor of the fact that the politics was so governing at any point in time that it was, unless you wanted to kill yourself, you wouldn't indulge in it. And I feel that even today, most Kashmiris shift and they're very reluctant to talk about politics. You talk to an ordinary Kashmiri in Srinagar today and ask him, are you with NC or PDP? He'll give you shifty answers. He's with both. Or if you ask him whether he supports freedom, what does the sense of freedom mean to him? He will say both things. He will say what the plebiscite front once said, or he would say what Sheikh Abdullah said little later in 1977. So the point today I am making is that unless the world comes together to make Kashmir a Switzerland again, where nobody should interfere, there should be no violence, remove it of all violence, whatever method you have, whether bilateral talks or multilateral talks, geopolitical influences are going to ruin this land.
Okay, so I'm going to back off and not answer the geopolitical aspect, because my interests clearly are more on the literary and cultural side. I see no reason to disagree with your statement that Kashmir is intelligent.
No, my
point is something very different. In a normal society that's functioning, if in that society you find that your ancestors wrote the Panchtantra and wrote the Kathasarit Saga, the oldest extant book of stories, and you find, oh my God, when the Panchtantra was translated into Persian, a country that some Kashmiris think they are closer to than India, the emperor of Persia offered half of his kingdom to Burzum, the translator, because he thought that was such a remarkable thing. And you see all of India reading Amar Chitra Katha, Panchtantra, and Katha Sarasaga. But in the valley, not a single person reads those stories to their child. If you have a normal society in which University of Kashmir, which actually has an anthem, believe it or not. And you can go and Google that anthem, and it talks about a land where Abhinav Gupta was born. Where not a single person in the valley knows who Abhinav Gupta is, then sir, that is not a society that is educated in its identity, in its culture, in its society. I don't care whether they are programmers or BPA BPO call centers. That is not what is causing violence. What is causing violence is they have lost completely their sense of identity. They haven't lost it once, they have lost it repeatedly. When they started off as Hindus, they became Muslims, they converted. Then as they became Muslims, they looked for affiliation with Iran. In fact, for a long period in Kashmir, you will see the writers, the intellectuals, referring to Kashmir as little Iran. Then when India became independent, they decided, oh, Iran is too far away. We are actually close to Pakistan, so we should learn Urdu and all that stuff, be Pakistan. And then they had another identity change, where today now Pakistan is not something they want to associate with. They have suddenly discovered they're closer to Arabia. So this is a society in great turmoil. The Kashmiri soul has been twisted and turned and is very ignorant of who they are. They have lost touch with their history. They have lost touch with their culture. They have lost touch with what made their society great. I'll give you one final example. In Kashmir, on auspicious occasions, they serve yellow rice. Affluent homes, they make rice with saffron. Less affluent homes, they make rice with turmeric. So when the stone throwing happened, you know, the women came out. They were following their traditional culture. They offered the stone throwers yellow rice. Along came the zealots and said, oh, no, 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 no. No, no, no. That is not religiously acceptable. Boom. That's what I mean when I say ignorance.
May I just, you know, you mentioned about something of, whether we can make Kashmir into a Switzerland. Actually, if you go back the last three decades or more, innately the Kashmiri has been brought up in a utopian concept. You don't need India, you don't need Pakistan. You have natural beauty in abundance. So you can be independent and be a Switzerland of this area. Funds will come from here, funds will come from there. This is the utopian situation when they talk about Azadi, as I understand it. And of course, the last years, post-80s, as he says, as, from that position, and they keep moving back and forth because of this reason, as you say, so that's what they're looking for. They don't want to say this, but that's what they're looking for. Has been this absolute disconnect, it's true. They, what is being taught to them is not their history. What is being for them to understand is not there. And it's a very comparatively immobile population. Men in the village will live in that village, will not go to the next village. They're very reluctant to travel outside. So therefore, their understanding sometimes gets restricted by where they are, and what they're taught. And that has not happened in a year or 10 years or 20 years. That's the tragedy of losing connect with what they were and what they are, but and being associated with something which they are not, and being told that this is what your history is.
True, sir. I meant Switzerland in two reasons. One is, if you look at the history of Switzerland, it was very violent before it became peaceful, until the entire region guaranteed its peace. And the second point, which I forgot to ask, I wanted to conclude with him, how much of influence was Genghis Khan on the food? Because that's geopolitics.
So that's actually a very good question. When the story starts, Genghis Khan had actually died a few years before that, and Marco Polo had returned back to his hometown. So China was in a slight state of uncertainty, but at that point in time, Kashmir was more concerned about the West, because Kashmir had been attacked by Ghazni, but Ghazni did not succeed. And so he eventually set his sights down south. So they were more concerned about the threat from the West than they were concerned about China.
Yeah, one last question.
Yes. Good
Good evening, sir. I'm effectively asking for a sneak peek into your book in a way.
Yes.
Because you'd mentioned that the Kotarani had stood for and made an example of certain ideals or certain principles. I don't recall specifically what you mentioned, but through what acts in her book, through what did she, as an administrator, what did she do as a person, what example did she set that embodied these examples or these principles? The second thing is, I did read a little bit around your book, and as I understand, Kotarani was, and please correct me if my understanding of this is incorrect, but she was a Manglik. That is a person who was born with the sign of Mars. And that's something you have covered in the first chapter of your book. I would be interested to know from a literary perspective how you decided to, or why you decided to play this up, or to emphasize this.
When you research her story, and when you go that deep in history, all that history does is it whispers to you, right? And you have to sort of have a very fine ear. And you get a sense of a woman who was willing to sacrifice her love, her own desires, for the better good of her people. And her marriage to Rinchana must have been a very agonizing decision for her. Very, very, very agonizing decision for her. I knew that Rinchana died very shortly after he married. So that was a given, right? And so, knowing that most likely she was consulting an astrologer, if you just deduce backwards and say, she probably was told your first husband will die very quickly, so go ahead, marry this guy. Let him be the sacrificial lamb. So I could create the literary whodunit out of that.
So it was a literary device.
It was a literary device.
All right. Yes. Thank you.
Yes. Okay.
We're almost 1 minute to eight, and we usually wind up at eight. So before I close, I just have a couple of announcements. We have two programs coming up, very close to one another. The next one is on 19th of November. Chennai International Center probably usually says that we are a spa for the mind. So these two topics would actually have you typical and synonymous with the topic. It is Uncompromising Ethics for a Compromised World. The panelists are Samdong Rinpoche, who is the former Prime Minister of Tibet in exile, an eminent Buddhist scholar, and Priyadarshi, who is a director, Center for Ethics and Transformation, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT, along with Sri S. Gurumurthy. They're having a conversation on 19th November at 6:30 here at the Madras School of Economics. Very closely followed on the 20th by a very well-awaited program. The Sadhguru is going to address us, along with Mr. Gopal Srinivasan and Raju Venkatraman, on the topic, In Conversation with the Mystic. So that's going to be a really large crowd, so we are moving it to the ITC Grand Chola on 20th of November at 6:30 p.m. So these two programs are back to back on 19th and 20th. We look forward to seeing you all there. And finally, to propose a word of thanks. Firstly, my thanks are to the Honorable Chief Justice for having graced this occasion. Well, every one of you, though no questions were asked at him rather, would have known him every day through the newspapers. He's been doing a lot to the state, to the city, and to the judiciary and the lawyers in particular. And I would have loved to ask him a question, what he as a Kashmiri has got a connect with Tamil Nadu in the last 2 years. And he's virtually kind of entrenched himself into the society here. You can, any weekends you travel, you can surely find him in a mall in a nice t-shirt or a shirt and jeans too, interacting with a lot of people there, trying to get to know the Tamil culture and also the people's minds. He's not just a Chief Justice of the High Court. He's virtually gone into the society. And the moment I requested him for this program, I found Lord should pardon me, I found a very selfish smile also, because he said, I know Rakesh so well. And he started talking to me more about the book, more about Rakesh and how he knew him. And he was so happy to be here, and my job of inviting him was less. So thank you, sir, for having made this occasion a nice one. And to Mr. Rakesh itself, we have seen you only through the book, seen you in flesh and blood of what your thoughts are. And in fact, I heard a lot about you only through the Honorable Chief Justice. And thank you, sir, for having come and made a nice presentation here. And to all the friends who have come here, the judges, the other dignitaries, and also other friends and the members, kindly make it for other programs too. And thank you, one and all, for having made this program a nice one. Thank you all, and good night.